Luncheon. I'm looking at where we are. Somewhere down Cast iron. There it is. Cast iron. 11:30. And so this is just a kind of an open invitation to anybody who wants to come and be a part of a lively group of people eating as well as talking about pretty much nothing. So we have a great time. And then coming up very soon, next Sunday is Mega Sunday. And the reason it's called Mega Sunday is we've got so many things to fit into our fall schedule. And this is kind of our kickoff. We have God's Word, our hands, which, by the way, we're going to be kind of looking at the garden in the front of the church, and we're going to, it sounds like pretty self-serving, but actually it's not. We're going to recreate that space and put in a pollinator garden there. We want all of the monarchs and otherwise to come and share their beauty with us next year. So hopefully you can bring your gloves, some shovels or whatever, and we'll create a nice space for the butterflies. Then I'm looking at what else we've got here. Next September 17th is Chum Service, and we have a guest speaker coming for that. And then also a time for questions and answers. So if you have some questions about Chum, we'll have someone there to kind of address those and look at those things that you were wondering about Chum, how it operates, whatever. So then we get to September 24th, like we don't have enough announcements. Want to get you thinking about our stewardship, beginning our stewardship. We will have a guest speaker, and then also we have invite you to bring your lawn chairs. We'll be down in the lower parking lot. We have a potluck supper.
Not potluck.
Not potluck. It is.
Stewardship and fellowship are providing a tailgate breakfast.
That's why I'm glad that you're here today. We've been back and forth on this thing a lot, so sorry about that. But come and be a part of that, looking forward to some time together to kind of get our minds around stewardship this year. It's called a kickoff, and so we have some fun activities for us to do as well. Now and the rest I'm going to let you read through the rest. Now a little bit of sad news too. I don't know how many of you have heard, but Teresa's husband passed away on Monday. She is our parish secretary, our executive assistant. Very sad, had a heart attack and just passed away. So a couple things, the funeral's coming up very soon. Looking for those who might help volunteer, bring cookies and bars for the funeral. A little bit more about that on this coming Sunday. And then she sent already a note. I mean, I tried to tell her, stay out of the office, you know, you're fine. But as you can see, she didn't do that, so whatever. Dear Kenwood family, thank you so much for your care and concern for me at this time. It means more than you could ever know. Thank you for the beautiful flower, bouquet that was delivered to my home. Love, Teresa. Keep Teresa, the family, in your prayers this week. Any other announcements this morning? A lot, so. Let us begin our worship service with some prelude we need to prepare our hearts.
Forgive us for the unjust demands you place on others. and your creation. Forgive us for the ways we turn away from you and our neighbors. Forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. Amen. Remain standing for our gathering hymn on number 879.
Gracious Lord.
O God, we thank you for your Son, who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example and point us to the path of obedience. Give us strength to follow your commands through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise for the affirmation.
Look like.
So you look at the outside and say, oh, that one looks kind of nice. You take that one home, and invariably what happens when you take that watermelon and you open it up? What happens? It's not so good. It's pulpy, right? It gets dry. Like, yeah, it didn't get enough water at the right time. And so it really is no good. So you know you have to get rid of it. What's a good watermelon? How do you know a good watermelon? No, you don't know. I mean, you know, little of this. That's what Joe did this morning. He said, this was the hardest one of the little watermelons. And hopefully she knows what she's talking about, and we will have good watermelon for lunch today. But the important thing is this. Outside doesn't always tell you what's inside, right? So you look at it, you're not sure until you get inside. I think that's what's happening in today's lesson. And Peter is suddenly confronted with the Jesus on the inside that he didn't anticipate. He kind of knew what he thought Jesus was all about. I am the Messiah, something like that. But now he has to figure out, and Jesus says some things that makes him think, that's a rotten inside. I don't want to have anything to do with that. So there's a little bit of a discord with what we see on the outside and what we think is going on inside. So we've got to deal with that today. Want to talk a little bit more about that? Kids, don't worry about brush your teeth, okay? Eat your watermelon, it's all right. It's all right. Mom and Dad will direct you. What is good? What's good on the inside as well as the outside? Well, good morning again. May the wonder of God's grace fill and guide our lives today. Amen. So, here's the question we've heard many times if you're any kind of parent at all. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? When there's a child or a parent, sometimes it seems like the journey's just keep going on and on and on, right? In fact, these are times when we think we want have arrived. There are those moments we think we've arrived only to discover that we still have way further than we thought. Joan and I took a trip out to California. Actually, it was the Los Angeles area, not California. And we were driving the vehicle back, and we looked at the map and said, oh, wow, we're already here. And we decided we were going to stay a little bit longer, took a little sightseeing around the Grand Canyon. It was really wonderful until we realized that the sign we were reading, 379 miles, we thought that was to Denver. That was to the border of the state. And I don't know why people do that. They should never do that, right? Just kind of confuse you a little bit. So we had a lot further to go. Maybe we see familiar surroundings or have a sort of deja vu feeling. But in the end, all we can do is wait. Gotta stick with it. The destination will reveal itself, but sometimes it takes some time. That's exactly how I feel about today's gospel lessons. We have been on this journey of discovery for a few weeks, and even today it is still not over, but it has taken a very deliberate turn today. This road has been filled with twists and turns, and all of them have led us to try and answer one question throughout the last 4 or 5 weeks. Who is Jesus? Who are you? Who do you think I am? Who is he? We can tell you things about him. He comes from the northern Israel. He was born in a small farming town of Bethlehem, which, by the way, Bethlehem, if you don't know, the word means the field of wheat, okay? So it's a kind of a rolling hill area of Bethlehem. It is the wheat capital of Israel. We know he is different. He's gifted and that God seems to be with him. We know he cares about people, and not just important people. In fact, he spends most of his time with the least of all peoples, the poor, the ill, the rejects of his society, and he heals them, he feeds them. He seems to care about them. Maybe he even loves them. And that is so strange, since by most accounts, good people, godly people, would have nothing to do with those people. But Jesus does. And that confuses us. Are we there yet? Who is Jesus? Then there's the story. Some say miracles like water turned to wine and feeding 5,000 people out in the desert, a deserted place. Oh, and that didn't even include women and children. And that's another thing. He seems to care about women and children and widows and paralytics and, well, all kinds of other people, all kinds of undesirables. tragic choice, after all. It's not like being a fisher was some prestigious job of some sort, but they seem dedicated to him. They follow him. The journey of discovery includes all of this and more. Who is Jesus? Then there's Peter. Yes, you heard the story of the rock. Not that rock. Not, you know, Dwayne Johnson rock. Not him. Not the wrestler, actor person. No, the rock, Peter, who thought he could walk on water. Well, in a way he did, for a few steps. But then he looked a bit closer, and instead of keeping his eyes on Jesus, I just happened to notice that there were these huge waves, and it was stormy outside, and they were crushing over him. And okay, well, again, there was Jesus. Strange, ghostly, walking on water, and reaches out to that same Peter, the rock, from drowning, and pretty cool, actually, what he did. But then Jesus asks his fishermen friends who they think he is, and go abroad, Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Wow, I didn't see that one coming. But now that I think about it, it makes some sense, right? These have been things that were talked about in scriptures from a long time, this image of Messiah, someone who would vanquish all Israel's enemies, a mighty warrior king who would reestablish Israel as the mighty nation, the Messiah's kingdom and rule would never end, and of course, he would be really important to them. Is it possible that Peter, the unsinkable rock, actually gets it right? Is it possible that he understands who Jesus is? Perhaps Jesus seems to say as much, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. Whatever. At least there seems to be some progress in our journey to discovering the true identity of Jesus. Then another twist in the road happens. And it's like we want the true Jesus to please stand up. Remember that old TV program where there were three people, it was supposed to be someone, and then all pretend to be that person, and then finally at the very end, with the real so-and-so, please stand up, and Jesus is there. And we ask him, please stand up. You know, Peter, Jesus begins to tell his fishermen, friends, about the road ahead, I will go to Jerusalem. And I will suffer at the hands of the elders and temple authorities. Oh, yes, and they will eventually kill me. But first, our journey is not over yet, because 3 days after that, after they put me to death on a cross, guess what? Wait for it. What? I will be raised. Journey over, or almost. Well, if you want to be one of my followers, you too will need to take up your cross and follow me as well. Okay? Because if you want to save your life, you must be prepared to lose it. Yes, this is the story you were anticipating, right? Was this the journey that you thought that you were on? So what's our story? Who do we say that we are? Are you, or is Kenwood, a follower of the Jesus that is ready to take up his cross in order to truly live? There is no easy storyline here. There is nothing about just going along for the ride here. In the gospel, even if we gain the whole world, are we still living? What is life all about? Then how does Jesus' story draw you and me into a new way of living? The ending is rather subtle. What will you give in exchange for your life, for the journey you are living? What gives you life? I am testing that each day. God is not bothered by my questions. God knows that making things easy is tempting, but truly living is dangerous all on its own. Living outside our comfort zones brings us in contact with many other people. And it's there that the kingdom and the rule of God is seen and somehow known. So, travel light this week. See whom God sends on your path to give you the joy of seeing him and his kingdom at work. And know this, that whoever you are, Jesus walks the road, sometimes incognito, with you. Blessings on your people. So now comes the Sunday organist portion of our worship service. I know you're expecting that. Does someone have a hymn that they would like to throw out? Or sing a verse or whatever, a couple, two, three hymns? Send them all. Raise your hand at once, because that's, you know, not losing. What was that?
Finlandia.
That's way at the back. I will tell you in 1 second.
887,
everybody. So we are going to sing, let's see, how many verses are there? This is not easy things that we do. 887. This is my song. This is the first and last verse of 887.
Thank you.
838. And I'm thinking, how about first? I don't want to do first and last because they're about this. Oh, first and last. It'll be fine. Made known through Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Share the peace with friends and neighbors and those who are new to our community.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. You may receive it. Holy Communion this morning can be received in two ways. One, if you brought it back in individual packets, you're welcome to take them out and use them at this time. And then also we have bread and gluten-free bread for those who need gluten-free bread. And then our chalice has both wine and grape juice in it. And the wine is the dark red and the grape juice is the lighter color. And then I'm going to be pouring waters into our baptismal font. And as you come by, you are welcome to dip your fingers in the water of baptism and make a sign of the cross to remember your baptism into Christ's death and resurrection. So come now, for all has been made ready. And know this, and I hope that you will know this, everyone is welcome at this table here at Kenwood. One, because it's not a Lutheran meal, and secondly, it's not our meal, it's the Lord's table. At the Lord's table, everyone is welcome. So come now.
God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names,
And the Spirit who lives in you bless you now and forever. Amen. So we're at that kind of final chapter here of our worship service, so we're going to need a song. Does anyone have another song?
595.
595, is that 595 it is?
And if we could sing all three verses so we remember our loved ones.
Well, stand on the last verse. 595.
Thanks be to God.